Late film critic Roger Ebert was famously ratioed in 2005 for claiming that video games aren't art. Hearing of his position then, I reacted the way that most gamer folk did. Adamant denial of his sentiment and mockery of the old man for his old brain and old thinking.
Am I so out of touch? No. It's the children who are wrong.
Silent Hill 2 had proven to me in 2001 that games can be sophisticated, beautiful experiences capable of standing toe-to-toe with any traditional art form. But I made a critical error back then that I only recently corrected. I didn't actually read Ebert's argument. See, Ebert was never opposed to the idea that games could be emotionally worthwhile experiences, saying, "I am prepared to believe that video games can be elegant, subtle, sophisticated, challenging, and visually wonderful." In fact, there seems to be a bit of a misunderstanding when it comes to Ebert's view on games, in that he wasn't simply criticizing them, he was criticizing their audience. For most gamers, video games represent a loss of those precious hours we have available to make ourselves more cultured, civilized, and empathetic. Coming from any other developer, Devotion might have been yet another PT clone. Its first-person perspective combined with household setting, repeating areas, and scary lady outright demand that comparison. But the developers at Red Candle did something with the format that precious few have. They realized the power that format has when imbued with personal meaning. In doing so, they didn't simply profit off of PT's success. They elevated the genre. There's this thing in horror media that I'm just gonna call the contract, which I'll detail more in an upcoming video. But for right now, just know that it's a means of generating tension. It's what happens when you enter into a horror experience with the intention of being scared.
Mom, look around.
No, this is gonna make me
sad. Think of it like actual contracts that some haunted houses have visitors sign. Just the act of signing something that says, "You may die because this shit is so scary," generates enough tension to cause people to not want to go in. For Devotion, let's add a clause to that contract. Yes, you will be scared, Red Candle have a masterful understanding of tension, but you should also go into the game knowing there's more to be gained from this experience. If you're willing to look for it, Devotion offers insight on Taiwanese culture in the 1980s, serves as a cautionary tale about the dangers of misplaced love, and portrays the disastrous consequences of stigmatizing mental health issues. If I were to give Devotion a traditional score, it would undoubtedly be 2 thumbs up, 5 stars, 10 out of 10, or some such. But rating the game almost does it a disservice. How do you rate earnest feelings toward a culture determined to predict a future for children before they've even learned how to walk? How do you rank a meditation on the damage uncriticized faith can cause? At their core, reviews serve as a way to tell whether a piece of media is worth your time. To prevent a loss of those precious hours we have available, as Ebert put it. But a traditional scoring system falls apart when tasked with conveying greatness, at relaying some media as more than merely worthwhile time investments. Ebert understood this and had his own philosophy on what constitutes a great movie.
We all are born with a certain package. We are who we are, where we were born, who we were born as, how we were raised. We're kind of stuck inside that person. And the purpose of civilization and growth is to be able to reach out and empathize a little bit with other people. Find out what makes them tick, what they feel about, what they care about. And for me, the movies are like a machine that generates empathy. If it's a great movie, it lets you understand a little bit more about what it's like to be a different gender, a different race, a different age, a different economic class. A different nationality, different profession, different hopes, aspirations, dreams, and fears. It helps us to identify with the people who are sharing this journey with us. And that, to me, is the most noble thing that good movies can do, and it's a reason to encourage them and to support them and to go to them.
Devotion isn't a movie, and it isn't merely a good game. Devotion is the reason that I play games. Because no matter how many awful, empty, or even downright harmful games are made each year, Devotion proves how meaningful this art form can be. So, please, play Devotion. And if you're making any kind of Game of the Year list, I beg you to consider including it. Devotion came out in 2019, but was only available for a week before being review bombed for having a Winnie the Pooh, Xi Jinping joke that the developers accidentally left in. And for a brief period in December of 2020, GOG was going to release Devotion on their platform, until they walked that back due to, quote, many messages from gamers, aka pressure from China. Because of all this bullshit, some people haven't even realized Devotion was finally re-released in March of this year on Red Candle's website for both PC and Mac. Despite that bit of good news, the whole situation feels so unjust considering how incredible the game actually is. So please, gaming media, consider Devotion in your Game of the Year conversations. It may not win, but merely talking about it would send a powerful message.
爸爸，我们回家吧。